Mr. Chairman, distinguished guests, fellow brothers and sisters, I stand here today as a medical doctor who witnessed the ravage of war. I am also here today as one of the representatives of the people of North Province in Sri Lanka, a region which is home to 80% of Hindus in Sri Lanka, and a region which is borne full brunt of civil war for over 3 decades. As the Minister of Health, who has the unviable task of nurturing back a highly traumatized group of people who are struggling to recover from the dire effects of civil war, where a firm political solution still remains a mirage, I thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak to you. The suffering of our people is not something new to many of you. You are here today. In fact, in 1998, at the first International Conference on Hindu Solidarity held in Paris, an occasion which was attempted by BJP and VHP officials, the plight of my people was featured heavily, with the resolution condemning the attacks perpetrated by the Sri Lankan security forces on Hindus and Hindu temples. Similarly, as the war ended in 2009, leaving behind dire humanitarian consequences, the meeting of the Central Governing Council of Vishwa Hindu Parishad, held at Banswara, Rajasthan in July 2009, urged the government of Sri Lanka to address the humanitarian crisis in a comprehensive manner, while impressing upon the need to work towards a political solution to address the ethnic problem in Sri Lanka. In fact, that the Central Governing Council aptly captured, within 2 months of the end of the war, the suffering of more than 300,000 internally displaced persons who were confined to military administered refugee camps. I would like to take this opportunity to thank you for standing by our people and lending them your moral and political support at the time of our greatest need. The bond that exists today between us was not one forged in the past decades or so. It is ancient. We share more than religious roots. Our people's culture, their language, and way of life is deeply rooted in this land. At times, we have also shared common challenges as during the time of colonialism, which in many ways structured the existence of our people, laid the seeds of conflict, and whose effects are felt to this day. Amid such turbulent periods, champions of religion, language, and culture have emerged to protect our culture and identity. Armuga Navalar, who spearheaded Hindu revival in the mid-19th century among the Tamil Hindus, who considered Northeast as their home during the dark period under British rule, come to my mind. Described by great men of his time as the Hindu of Hindus, Navalar was credited with stonewalling missionary efforts to spread Protestant Christianity and prevailing the religious and cultural identity of the Tamil people. Although Navalar's life began in Jaffna, he worked on both sides of the Park Straits in mission for Hindus' revival. He crossed the Park Straits and went to Madras to look at Saiva schools, meet scholars, and draw inspiration from the religious leaders of that time. But that is not all. He made Madras and Jaffna the twin centers for his reforms. To the printing press he set up in Jaffna, he added one in Madras. The Saiva school he established in Vannarpanai, Jaffna, was matched by one in Chidambaram, Tamil Nadu, and so went his mission for Hindu revival. 137 years since the passing of Navalar, today our people face a life that Navalar would not have never imagined. After having faced entrenched structural discrimination, state-sponsored violation since independence in 1948, and a brutal civil war, Tamil people of North and East, regardless of their religion, language, or culture, face a changed political, economic, and socio-cultural environment. The war did not spur the places of worship. The Ministry of Hindu Religion and Cultural Affairs data on damages to temples in the north and the east of Sri Lanka says, out of the 1,607 temples registered with the ministry, 1,479 have suffered severe damage due to the military activities. This is 1998 data. It is more than 80% of the registered temples. Other sources of data list the number of temples completely destroyed, which is nearly 250. In addition to the physical damage, the religious institutions also faced another troubling phenomenon, that was the theft and smuggling of religious artifacts, many of which were centuries old and even survived colonial onslaughts, and the loss of Sanskrit scriptures and records dating by hundreds of years. Beyond the physical damage suffered by these religious institutions, the war also prevented the conduct of religious observances and festivals, as embargo on travel, food, fuel, electricity supply, and dust down curfew stifled normal life. I must say at this juncture that the attacks against places of cultural and religious significance is a phenomenon that has remained a constant in post-colonial Sri Lanka. In this instance, it is fitting to recall the destruction of Jaffna Public Library in 1981 by the state-sponsored mobs, well before the start of civil war in Sri Lanka, and the loss of 95,000 volumes of rare, historical, culturally important, ancient manuscripts, which has been deprived for future generation. On the same day, the mobs also burned down the Hindu temple adjacent to the library. Both were symbols of our people. While the physical impact of the war is measurable and could be addressed with the availability of capital and human resource, the psychosocial scars of the war are not measurable and cannot be addressed within the particular time frames. They are enduring and non-identifiable. According to the report produced by the End Peace Network, UNDP initiative titled Women's Perspectives of Peace and Security, the war has left around 86,000 widows in the north and the east of Sri Lanka. In addition to the war widows, there is a category of women who do not know whereabouts their husbands, as the large number of men who surrendered in the last stages of war still remain missing, as many who are subjected to white van abductions. Added to the above, we also have around 12,000 ex-combatants who surrendered in the last stages of war and subjected to a government-designed rehabilitation program which did not adhere to accepted international norms and practices on disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration of ex-combatants. According to UN and NGO sources, the war had also cost more than 40,000 to 60,000 lives in the large stages of war, with 13,000 more injured. Many of the injured are disabled at present. Added to that, as of February 2014, according to the International Internal Displacement Monitoring Center, which is part of the Norwegian Refugee Council, 90,000 people are still living in the internal displacement, and most of them with host communities. The issue of post-war northern and eastern provinces are further compounded by the vast area of land being taken by the military to further expand their infrastructure, leaving behind thousands who are unable to exercise their right to return to their original place of habitation, contrary to the accepted international conventions and norms. As reported by various media outlets, more than 7,000 square kilometers of land in the war-torn regions have been seized by the government for its own use. These lands include temples which are sacred to our people. Added to it, as per calculation made by the International Crisis Group in March this year, around 120,000 military personnel are stationed in our province, and went on to say that figure presents one army member for every 8.7 civilians. You are wonder why these facts are figure, why these facts and figures are matter. They matter because the effects of war do not end when the war comes to an end for official purpose. The physical, human, political, social determinants continue for years or even across generations. They matter because it shows that the civil war. Acts of rape and sexual. Acts of rape and sexual violence, which still remains endemic and highlighted by the Freedom House in 2013 and UNHRC in 2010, especially against women and girls, are in the former conflict areas, keep our female population who bore a brunt of war in the permanent state of trauma. These traumatized groups are in desperate need of psychosocial care, livelihood assistance, safe and security to lead the normal life. Unfortunately, the highly militarized nature of the northern province is not at all conducive to ensure their livelihood, safety and security. In the northern province of Sri Lanka, there are three groups of most vulnerable population living in the north and east. Especially there are, you know, more than 78,000 young widows who are actually unable to live because they have no any support from anyone, and they find even to meet the day-to-day needs with their three or four kids. And also other group of people actually living in Sri Lanka in the northern east provinces who lost their husbands, and also other group of people actually who does not know where their husbands are still. They are waiting for their loved ones to return to their homes. And also there are more than 18,000 people with special need. Actually they have nothing, they have no program for their for their future, and actually this is only 11 minutes allocated for me. This is not the matter to discuss whatever the problems we have in Sri Lanka, especially for the Hindus. Anyway, I would like to again tell you the things actually we have to. I have never seen when the Hindus were discussed, the problems of Hindus were discussed, and nobody mentioned about Sri Lanka. In future, at least, I think we have to take care of the Hindus in Sri Lanka. Thank you very much.